Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
You'll be a dentist. You have a talent for causing pain. Come be a dentist. People will pay you to be inhumane.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade's Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Ben, suddenly Seymour Fowler, with Will, feed me, Heim, and Ryan, I'd be a dentist, Slowoski. Tim, on Skid Row Hannon, is currently being thrown from a cruise ship by his wife, and will not be joining us on this podcast.
We can only hope the reports are true.
Lost at sea.
Lost at sea. Taken by, you know, the Inskip people, so.
It's true.
The deep ones.
Maybe they will accept him.
This week on the STABcast, we have a battle report, maybe, and some listener mail.
It counts.
At least one of us still loves you.
There's more stuff out there.
There's stuff happening.
There's lots of
stuff. We're gonna stretch it.
Yeah. We actually have a jam-packed, we actually have a lot of stuff to talk about this episode, but if we listed everything, one, there's no mystery, and two, it's a lot of, it seems random, but it's not random, it's all Legion and Legion adjacent, so.
It's a lead-in, it's supposed to get people interested, Ryan.
We are less than a minute in, but I feel good about this episode, so. We're getting out of our rut, we're doing some new and interesting things.
You're getting out of your rut, Ben, so you went out and played Legion?
No. In fact, I did not. Remember, episode, I told you all, I played enough Legion to carry me through at least till Christmas. So I'm in my camel phase. I have some really good news. My literature review was accepted this past Friday. So I'm now 20% of the way done with my dissertation.
There you go.
So that feels good. You know, good 45 pages and, you know, something like 102 references. I feel good about it. So it's accepted. There's even hope that I can possibly get this finished by our winter break this year, get the first two parts done. So I would be 60% of my way through my dissertation if I'm lucky by winter break. So I feel good, but that's why I can't play Legion. I've got to get this thing finished. I can feel it. I can taste it so close.
Ben is the podcast succulent.
Yes.
Storing water.
Yes. I'll survive.
One way to put it.
Well, how dare you not play Legion, Ben? God.
Listen, buddy. I know you didn't play Legion.
I painted Legion.
I saw your paint pictures. You put them on, you know, the Instagram, and then I saw you go play MCP. Facebook tells me everything.
Oh no.
Yes.
You're cheating on us, Will. You're cheating on us.
Absolutely I am. Y'all ain't worth shit. Yeah, I've been playing a lot of MCP because it's the only game I can get to the store and have time to play with my new work shift lately.
Yeah, that's honestly the truth. And we've talked about that before with this game.
Yeah.
I love Legion. It's just a 3-hour, 4-hour game if you're really going to set up, do the thing, tear down, and go home.
The earliest I can get to Sci-Fi City now is about 6:30, and that's really pushing it. Like, someone has to be sitting there with their table and list ready for me, and I'm just, even then, it's going to be a rush.
Mm-hmm.
So. Sure. I've been getting some Marvel games in with Darren, one of our local players. You know, I've been just having some random fun. But then I've been keeping up. I just painted the Mando and IG-11 so they can go in my bin of Rebels and back in the closet.
Right.
But they're done and cool.
Nice. I'm not going to say that I'm jealous of the time you get to spend with Darren, but he's a cool individual.
He's a cool guy.
When I play games with him. So.
Absolutely.
He's tempted by Legion lately, so he might come back to us.
But he likes to play all those weird little small skirmishy games, like, you know, Bushido and
I've told him that I've told him Legion Skirmish is a wasteland of horrible content, so he knows he'd have to go full in.
I mean,
but he still has his Rebel army from like 3 years ago, so he'd just have to get those,
get some updates.
Skirmish is fine. It's not
until someone like you comes around is like, how can I break this entirely?
Whoa.
I mean is he plays more skirmishy type games, small forces kind of things.
Marvel, Guild Ball, all those.
Yeah.
Yeah. Malifaux.
Like skirmish.
No, just that more competitively minded people can find a lot of exploitation in skirmish is what I mean.
Yes. I mean, anything that shoots beyond range 3 on a 3x3.
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
Table seems real bad.
There's a lot of stuff that's bad in full games and is very good in skirmish because suddenly all its downsides are mitigated.
Yeah, that is
yes.
Fair.
Yes.
And it's just hearing skirmish lists are always just, I don't want to go to that wasteland anymore. It's like, here's my triple taunt Luke skirmish list. Like, how?
Look, I thought as the reigning champion of the Atlantic City Open skirmish circuit, yeah. with my T-47, which didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Rebel Vets yeah. are good, yo. It wasn't yeah. the T-47.
When we first played this game at Adepticon, when they first premiered it, we were all on 3x3 mats, and that was definitely a thing that you were like, yeah, it's right there. And you're like, okay, I'm just going to eye on it because it's also right there. So then it was like,
oh, that opening.
3x3 makes that space real tight.
Yeah, but it also made
I played an ATST back then.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And I it got killed by Z6 guns.
As you do.
Since Will and I did not play any games, we do have news from STABcast North. Tim won his first game in Rochester.
What?
It only took 8 weeks and 25-ish games, but you know, he got there.
He got there.
Do we have confirmation that it wasn't just a, fine, you can win one here?
It has not been peer-reviewed.
Independently confirmed.
Or cannot confirm nor deny that it was not gifted to him to make him feel better.
I mean, if you throw enough dice at people, I guess they would say, all right, buddy, you won.
Or if you complain enough about your minis dying, they might say, all right, fine, Jesus.
If you break the kneecaps of your minis in your clenched fist, I mean, maybe a guy will be like, yeah, you won that game. You won that game, buddy.
Whenever Tim fields a unit that the model is just the feet on the base, it was his rage.
I like to call it his Ozymandias bases, you know, yes. Just kneecaps.
It's look upon my works.
Ye mighty and despair.
Ye non-salty and despair.
Of course, in a field full of sand.
Yes.
Listen, we always send the best up north, so enjoy north.
Yeah, y'all have fun with that one.
Then he fled on a boat, as is his wont.
You know, I don't know where this cruise is. I assume someplace warm. I guess it could be like the Great Lakes.
Yeah,
just cruising up and down Ontario and Michigan. And
dear listeners, I have come with games in hand to actually contribute Legion to this Legion podcast.
Boo.
Yeah, I know, right? One of our locals, Chad, had the sad displeasure of playing me 2 weeks in a row. We played 1 week because we hadn't played, and then I showed up as the odd man out, and the guy he was going to play had something come up, so we got a rematch. And Chad's been playing. He does something I really like, where he's got a shtick, and he's gonna work it, and he's beaten me twice. They have been both incredibly close games down to dice rolls. But he brings this Iden Inferno ISF paired with an ATST. It's things you don't normally like see together. And he plays it really well. And he's a fun opponent for me to play against. Because I'm a very aggressive player. And he is, by his own admission, like the objectives come second to him. And he wants to play shooty. And he's really good about drawing you into gunfights you don't want to be in. He's also got Bosk in that list, which is wild. So it's like three very different kind of high-level threats.
But if he makes you choose which one to engage with,
and exactly,
leaves you open with the others, I mean, ooh.
First time we played, I ran my Cincinnati list, the Mandos, Sabine, Cass. And I switched things around in our second game, which I think was probably the more interesting of the two, where Sabine and Clan Ren came out, and I found a way to take my double, my commandos down to a strike team, two Wookiees, Cassian and Din Djarin. So it's got a lot more wounds and a little bit more closed melee threat, but not nearly as fast. And our second game, when I was coming to try to redeem myself, we ended up on hemmed in hostile environment and key positions, which I normally don't put in a battle deck. But with the new bounty keywords, I knew KP can really get upset by bounty, and that's something I kind of wanted to mess with.
Oh yeah, for sure.
By the way, has a stick and just keeps doing it. That could just be the title of our podcast.
Yeah, I was thinking about it. Continue.
So we deploy up. He puts his entire army save for Bosk and one of his ISFs that he infiltrated in one of his DZs. Everybody deployed pretty far back. I posture pretty aggressively. I've got a big building. Kudos to Chad. I had a really, really, really mean option for KP. Obviously, on hemmed in as blue player, I'm closer to the middle KP, and then there was like this random fence that was just outside my deployment zone that I could claim. And he had these big awkward cargo crates that were a mile, that either were in his deployment zone or a mile away from them. And so he had harder KPs to grab. So I cower my rebel troopers kind of behind a wall. I had a rebel officer and two rebel troopers. He sends Bosk around to kind of pressure there, marking my generic officer as his bounty target. And I snake around and try to throw one of my sets of Wookiees and Dind to go harass his safe KP while letting kind of Cass and K2, float where they need to. Excuse me. I made a decision and I think I came to regret it, where Cassian was in pistol mode. There was a lot of things for me to kind of duck and hide behind, and I didn't want to leave him exposed in sniper mode to where an AT-ST can pick him off, and I wanted to be able to run to the middle KP in the end game. And we start to skirmish, and the early parts of the skirmish very much go my way. I get some solid wounds. He takes some big hits into me. I run some rebel troopers out and get some wounds on Bosk to kind of keep him off of my point with just a random rebel trooper squad. My thought process is to keep Bosk aiming and shooting, and so he can't double run. He can't, like, spend the last three turns moving up to my KP and then blowing some guys off it to contest it. I wanted to keep him back as long as possible. That AT-ST is taking some shots onto to Din. I'm getting to spend some dodge tokens, and the red saves are coming up. So I'm not taking a ton of wounds. I'm trading actions, I think, pretty well. But in turns 3 and 4, Chad's dice, in both times I've played him, his dice are not amazing. But when they hit hard, and when they blank hard. And he just threw a couple of huge unmodified die pools that really let him get a tempo edge on my Wookiees to where their die pools are getting cut in half. I think an unmodified ISF with a T-21 got five or six hits into Wookiees without a name token, which is wild. And then going into turn 5, I drop crack shot, and I'm trying to get greedy because I've got a great pistol shot lined up for Cassian. I'm trying to wait and pull K2 before I do the first crack shot because I really want Cassian to have two aims because I'm going to be shooting into ISF or into Iden, who's going to be in heavy cover, and then just some random stormies. He goes concussive blast. Cassian's taken one wound at this point. And he gets his 5 hits on his 5 red with blast, which sucks. But I'm just like, Cassian just has to sit here and not roll 5 blanks. As long as I don't roll 5 blanks, I'm going to have a great crack shot turn. The big threat that can go into Cassian is over. And I can move on with my day and execute.
See, as a B1 player, you're going to roll 5 blanks. I know that.
I at least surge.
I'm not going to block anything.
I at least surge, though. I'm you know, I don't...
The problem is that you trusted them.
Yeah, I did.
You should never rely on the dice. You should expect nothing, and they'll surprise you.
They failed me. Cass died without getting crack shot off, which really hurt.
Good.
Din did then manage to clean up Iden, collect his bounty. But that left the AT-ST kind of unchecked, and K2 was not able... K2 was kind of my ace in the hole to be able to help, since we're playing hostile environment, for him to get to the center point. There was going to be a turn where he had to sit in the open. And he had played so defensively and so far back that I was just hoping he would run out of time before he could rush the middle point. And K2's suppressive gun would keep them back. But K2 died under fire to the AT-ST and an ISF squad. Once again, without aim tokens, that I was hoping the armor would do a little bit more mitigation than it did, and I would roll a few more saves. So my flank quickly collapsed. My last hope was Din, and it came down to the last die roll on Din. I've got my safe point. He's going to get the middle, and I think Din's going to be able to go tie up his safe point. But the AT-ST spun around and blew Din up, and then I conceded the game halfway through turn six. It was a tight game. Chad's a really good player. We approached the game very, 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 very differently, which is always fun to play against. And he's an absolute gentleman. And he also has a podcast, the Nerdy Old Men podcast. You guys should go follow it and listen. Chad's a great dude, and we're really lucky to have him in the community. But not to sound too haughty, but like in the local scene, I can't tell you the last time somebody beat me twice in a row.
So, I'm not saying it's a coincidence that Will and I didn't play any games, so that the only games you had to talk about were losses.
Yeah,
but I'm saying that worked out nicely. That feels like a nice bit of, you know.
It feels nice.
If you go back through the Wayback Machine and listen to the show, I normally talk about my losses more than my victories.
But I'm saying this entire episode of Battle Reports, it's just
that's
your
true. It's just 100% Ryan losses.
I mean, we could bring up how sometimes there's more to be discovered in a loss than in a win.
I believe that's 100% true. But needless to say, next time me and Chad play, I'm going to bring a not very nice list and, you know, remind him who was here first.
I hope he still beats you.
Yeah, he probably will.
Yes. And this is one of the reasons why I do love to get outside my normal play space and play other people, except, of course, when I go to Cincinnati and play both Ryan and Will.
Hold on.
I played three people I knew.
By definition, that is outside your play scope, because we remarked, remember the last time we played?
This is true. It's been a while.
Years ago.
But what I'm saying is that I love it when people, like, so Chad is bringing you in, forcing you to do things you traditionally don't have to do against other opponents you play locally.
Yep.
And so that is what changes that game up.
Yeah.
And gives me a place to score the points. Yeah. I love it.
Yeah. It's just the variety of play styles when you have a bunch of people you can play, you know, like everybody's got their own unique taste, whatever they prefer to do.
Ben and Will's best efforts, we do have a local community with lots of different play styles. You know,
pre-COVID, we had that struggle of people always arranging games and whether that was good or bad for our local community. Right. Because sometimes that excludes new players. And so if you're out at a game store and you just see a dude or a lady or whoever it is who's playing the game, you're just like, hey, listen, I'll play a game with you, complete stranger. Yeah. Let's go have some fun here. You really got to break outside your social norms. Go find the people who are
playing.
That's
how groups grow.
Yep, 100%.
Absolutely. Speaking of cinematic moments that Ryan will definitely not remember to post between now and the time this episode drops, be sure to check us out on the Instagram at STABcast. I post all of our photos that we get there, Will's painting, Will's cat, the games I played in Cincinnati. I posted a couple of those photos. I surprisingly didn't have as many photos as I thought. I had a lot of photos of battle decks for some reason.
Yeah, it's hard, but, Ben. Yeah. It's hard to take photos during games.
Well, no, the timing was so tight. I didn't have time to do anything else.
And we post the photos of important things.
Important things.
Games,
I'm about to post a photo of this blank map that Ryan and I played on because that was the only photo I had before our game started. But you can check us out at STABcast.
And if you tire of our pictures of blank terrain, you can find more of them on Facebook and Twitter. You can give us a rating on your listening platform of choice. You know, those reviews help us with visibility and all the things. Get us out there so more people can suffer our mediocre content.
Yeah.
Thanks. As always, we're available wherever the finest podcasts are streamed at STABcast. And we are also available within the hive of scum and villainy known as the Legion Discord.
The Legion Discord.
At STABcast, our name here. You know, it's STABcast true. Will, Ben, Ryan, and then that other one. You know, you can send us a message, ping us in a chat if you want to awaken us from slumber under the mountain.
I had to go explain what the difference between the Rocky Top Open and the Rocky Mountain Open was.
Yeah, I also got some messages about that, which I thought it was fairly clear, but
fairly obvious. But I mean,
I was summoned to observe a swoop bike that was created after being inspired by mine that was spearing a B1.
Nice.
I gave them lots of reacts and said they did a great job because it was great.
Rocky Top is a song played by winners and high level players of this game.
Wow,
in a jar, and the Rocky Mountains are just a mountain. So
you couldn't make that take last year, and we'll see if you're able to make it next year. But
we're in the moment, okay?
We're in the moment, and I'll let y'all enjoy it.
Thanks, buddy.
It was much fun. Much fun.
It's just like 2019 LSU.
Yeah, exactly.
Out of nowhere.
We consistently snake a championship every decade.
All right.
That is true. It's been a while for us.
We missed the 20... the last two.
last two decades.
Yeah. But now we're back at it. Yeah.
Back at it.
Please take us away from this.
If you want to support our little endeavor so we don't have to just talk about University of Tennessee football, you can support us by going to teespring.com/stores/stabcast, or you can drop us a line on what you would like to hear us ramble randomly about at swstabcast@gmail.com. I don't know, but our Teespring store might have some new stuff relatively soon. Ben was throwing some ideas at me before the show.
I've got some ideas for
you. Are we getting booty hats?
The next couple weeks? Yeah.
Some STABcast suspenders.
Yeah, absolutely.
We do have to find a STABcast bow tie. Yeah,
I can STABcast booty hats.
It does not surprise the listenership that I have made my own bow ties before. So.
That does not surprise me.
My own hand tied bow ties. Yes.
Hand sewn.
Oh, yeah, absolutely hand sewn. Please.
Places that you can find Ben wearing a bow tie. Where are we going to be found, folks?
Well, Ben won't be at them.
Yeah, you're right.
No, I probably won't be, but listen, it's because I'm working on this dissertation. I'm trying very hard. Mm-hmm. I'm getting there.
So you can go get a job. That means you won't be able to come out and make it and play Legion.
We talk about the events and then say whether or not we'll be there.
Yep.
That is the idea of this segment.
It's true.
It is.
So first up is the Golden State Games Worlds Qualifier. We actually are kind of going to be there. There are some fanny packs up for grabs, and I sent them a care package of some of our standing orders.
That's
cards.
Better than us coming.
Yeah, it's better than us
coming. Actually, probably is. I mean, yeah. So. I don't know. People have fun with us.
They have more fun with their fanny packs.
Yes.
What a man does with his fanny pack in the privacy of his own hotel room is his own business.
That's up to them, yeah.
I mean, that's no judgment.
Yeah, no. None whatsoever.
If I ever get fabulously wealthy, if I win $1 billion lottery prize on Wednesday.
tell.
I would just travel because I would love to go play in San Francisco. I would love to go play. Sure. Just pack my stuff up. Just travel around, go do the things. That would be a fantastic life to lead. I mean.
Well, then you could also go to the Queen City Charity Tournament in Concord, North Carolina on November 12th and 13th. It's a nice charity event. I don't know if any of us are going to be able to make it out. Yeah, it's a bit of a drive.
I've got other plans. I gotta attend. But I wish I could go because it's put on by some great people. And that's a community that I really like and want to play more games with.
Yeah. They're a lot of fun. A lot of fun. Good eating Concord as well. So the following weekend, Raleigh-Durham, they have an Atomic Games, November the 19th, which I think we had talked about going to because it fit in our game schedule.
Yeah.
Except, Will, what have you done, Will?
We are hosting a Knoxville tournament.
Woo!
Woo!
Sci-Fi City, November the 19th.
Just a little store event, nothing super special.
Just a little local thing, you know, we can get...
A little maybe. Friendsgiving activity before Thanksgiving. So
for sure. It's like the last chance before holidays take everyone on their separate ways to Thanksgiving, and then December flies by for Christmas. We'll be back with more Knoxville things maybe in the new year, but trying to get one in before the holidays take everyone away like that. So should be a fun time. We've got some prizes and things to give away and our tables and things we haven't really used at Sci-Fi City very often, so going to bust all that out, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Should
spend half my time just transporting tables back and forth.
Yeah. That's also true. I'm hoping to be at PAX Unplugged in December, 2nd through 4th, in Philadelphia. I'm not 100% confirmed on that, but it's looking okay. I'm excited. PAX should be a good time. It's a convention. I've always wanted to go to and never had the opportunity. And then in Boston, the next weekend, December 10th, we might send STABcast North too. Probably not. But, you know.
No, Tim's already said he's got the hotel room. The wife is approved. I mean, nice. He's down for it.
Good for him. He's going to embarrass himself in another state.
Yeah.
This is what happens, Tim, when you go on a cruise instead of joining us for a podcast.
That's true.
You could have brought the podcast microphone to your cruise room.
I'm just looking at the data. I'm looking at the trends. I plugged into to Legion stats here.
The forecast.
Tim's last win was a bye. So
last in how many games?
Win. Last confirmed win.
Yeah. So we'll
and actually, his win before that was also a bye. So his last two confirmed wins.
Oh no.
Was a bye in a different state and a bye in the tournament he was in. So
yeah,
when we establish a remote outpost, we don't send our best
Nope.
If the history of colonization has shown us anything, you send out all of your, you know, disreputable types. And if they survive, then you send out the other people.
So. Exactly. We're letting Tim tame the outback of Rochester, New York.
See the book White Trash for more information. It's actually a really fantastic discussion about that. But yeah.
Tim's establishing the penal colony of the stab game.
Wow. Pivoting away from this joke, me and hopefully Tim will be at the other penal colony, Las Vegas, for LVO in January. I'm super excited. It's one of my favorite trips every year. The big news is the Cherokee Open is coming back. And if you're listening to this, tickets should be on sale on Frontline Gaming's website.
Whoa.
They should be.
Should be.
Should be.
We had a fantastic time last year. I mean,
yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah, fantastic time. So we're geared up for some more. For some more.
Hopefully, yeah, February 22nd through more turnout.
24th. Same venue, same roughly weekend.
We're same looking bat at the time.
Same format. So should be a good time. Gonna be more casual than competitive because I really doubt we're gonna get a world's invite. I could be wrong, but I really doubt it.
Not a month before a
right around the corner.
But, you know, the different parts of the country, different parts of the
it's
country.
True. It's true.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was a fun event. I'm looking forward to being able to put it on again.
The venue is great. Yeah. It's a good time.
I think, I don't know that this is locked in yet, but I think we're going to try to do like I think Saturday night they're going to bring in food and do like a family style like barbecue buffet, North Carolina barbecue buffet, which would be cool.
Okay.
So, you know, because I know we had trouble finding food last year. And so if they're going to just bring it to us, that's going to be great.
But North Carolina barbecue is all vinegar.
It is all vinegar. It is. But I like all barbecue. I like it. So I like the low country vinegar barbecue.
That's true.
I mean, it could be mustard barbecue. Could be.
Could be.
As long as it's not Alabama white mayo barbecue.
Oh, no. Yeah, no.
That's just mayonnaise with pepper in it.
That is an affront to God.
Yeah, I'll take the vinegary stuff over like the Memphis kind of syrupy molasses stuff all day every day.
Oh, so yeah. I like barbecue, so I'll have it all. I'll take it all.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to say no to it, but
I'm not going to say no, but
are we having a STABcast barbecue rankings segment? Like going
because
Texas,
we'll never agree.
Texas, you weren't that great.
Well, I don't know. Oh, hold on.
Oh, I don't know if I
the best barbecue when I was at Dallas last year and they took me to, of all places, to Heim Barbecue downtown. It was a pretty amazing. I'm not gonna lie.
I mean, I'll be honest. Texas barbecue is not my top three. I mean, it's still good barbecue.
Yeah,
all barbecue is mostly good, but it is not in my top three. It is not.
I'm not saying it was unedible. It was nice and good, but it was. I mean, I like a little more flavor is all.
When you Texans send your hate mail, please put attention Will in
come
the
at me.
Line at SWSTABcast.
Come at me.
Will's never going to open the email inbox. It's just going to be me, guys.
Yeah. So well, then Ryan can forward it to me.
Yeah,
and
please
I'll go.
Just roast him publicly on the Discord.
Yeah, do it.
I mean, I guess if we're going there,
I'm
do
sorry,
enjoy St.
Do
Louis,
it, Floor.
Kansas City.
Do it.
They're not gonna roast you. They will.
I like
know,
a dry rub.
Slow cook you over some coals for 4 hours.
I do prefer molasses over the vinegar. So
at least I'd know they wouldn't use any spices on me.
Oh, listen, I can
the
already
entire
hear
state
Texas.
Is allergic
it's
to cayenne.
The wood.
Apparently,
it's the mesquite. It's the smoke.
Wow! It tastes like a campfire. I love that. I can get that on a s'more or a hot dog. Do something with it. God.
Hey, Will, you know, I think we have some news.
No, we don't.
The website is updated, Will. That is news in and of itself.
The news. They updated the website. There is now a link to the rules forum, which is actually kind of useful. Oh, I was always confused on where to get it before.
Yeah.
So,
I mean,
that's nice,
you
I guess.
You can see all three games now up there on the front page without circling to the little hamburger on the right. I mean,
it is nicer. Yes.
Legion is listed at the very top, so that's always nice.
Wow.
There's, for some reason, a good 6 inches of screen between the top of the window and the first link that's clickable, but, you know, mobile
future proofing
issues, I guess. The space rules form is publicly available. Like, listen, at least we've at least started. We've started that.
Sure. Yes.
So that feels good.
Yeah, it's a slow news week. When
it is a development.
The website is our leading headline.
There's lots of Marvel news, like Pyro and Blob and and Logan the Wolverine.
God, they look so good. They look so good. Will has started putting together his robots. They look very nice.
My Sentinels.
I am a big fan of Sentinels. I am.
I finally got Cyclops and Storm so I can play X-Men, even though I had every other character besides them for X-Men.
So you had no leader? Yeah.
Their box was out of stock for a long time. So
gold and blue team, man. Gold and blue team.
Storm is much better than Cyclops.
Do we not have a Professor X?
No.
No.
That's...
Not AMG. Yet.
What are you doing?
We have Cassandra Nova, which is kind of
his twin sister Xavier. From the utero womb, but also...
I don't know who that is. I don't...
Listen, it's a whole thing.
Just check out the Wikipedia. We could go into it here.
Or don't.
I'm doing a pivot. We're pivoting to the mailbag. We've got some listener questions to talk about.
We've got some mail. Yeah.
And you know what it's not about? It's not about Marvel Crisis Protocol.
Damn it. Is it about bad Texas barbecue?
No, that'll be our next episode's mailbag.
Yep, it will. Congrats, I've brought us content. You're welcome.
I don't know that this is the content I wanted, but I guess it's an improvement.
Insert gunshot noises.
I'll trust Florf's taste in Legion. I don't know that I'll trust Florf's taste in barbecue. Just going to be real honest there.
That's Florf the Dwarf, sir, to you.
Well, no, that's to you, not to me.
I stand with Florf.
You stand above Florf.
I mean, a lot of people do, but
yeah.
We got Zesty Will today.
Man, that barbecue joke was wild.
I'm ready to fight both of you because I know this topic coming up. You want me to read it?
Go ahead. You got your color on it.
From who wrote this? I don't know. Oh, it says that. Hello to all of you on the podcast. My name is Will. Well, this is weird. And I'm a relatively new Legion player. True. And I play Republic and Separatists. I'm getting the two Battle Force boxes, and I would love to know, outside of those units, what would be the best to get? P.S. I enjoy your show and have been listening since July. Keep up the good work. Also, I would like to know why you are so hostile to Arcs and Fluttercrafts.
So would the rest of the internet.
Okay, we're gonna divide this up.
Yeah. Let's
answer the first question, then we'll have a fight. So I'll start. If you've picked up the 501st box, you have lots of phase twos and arcs, which are fun and cool to paint. It sounds like you could easily pick up a Clone Wars core set to get Obi-Wan and some phase ones. I know you're already chock full of B1s, but you'll need Grievous. And you'll want some of those command cards, things like that.
How many B1s come in the Battle Force box?
Is it six?
I think it's six, yeah.
So then the two more you can field, the eight the Battle Force allows.
So like, yeah, okay. Honestly, buying the Clone Wars core set.
And Droidicas are in the Battle Force, but then another set are in the core set.
You'll get
an
extra Grievous, which kind of sucks.
Oh, true.
But everything else, he's in the Battle Force. Except for one... unit of B1s, which, you know, you might be able to offload to somebody at your local game store who just needs an extra set of B1s. Or break them up and throw them on your bases.
Yeah. Throw them on your clone bases is destroyed
might
B1s.
Might not be a bad way to go. So to really give you a lot of options.
Well, and you'll want Obi-Wan. You want the phase ones. Barks are great.
You only get three units of B1s. It just feels like six. You only get three inside the battle box.
Okay.
So then, a core set's even better,
because that'll get you up to six, and then you'll still need to potentially buy some more.
Then you can have two poses of Grievous, for when you play the one pip.
Yes. Yep. And then, you know,
you definitely want the upgrade B1s. You're definitely going to want some E5Ss. And they also make another core unit. So, like, you can actually get enough bodies out of that to make another unit.
The other thing I think, Ben can tell me I'm wrong, I think the very first purchase you should probably make after the core set, it's got to be Super Tacks, right?
Are they Battle Forced?
They're not Battle Forced, but if you're going to go buy a core set, it gives you a ton of options and some cool command.
Well, you could also get a normal T-Series, or is that in the Battle Force as well?
No, that's in the Personnel Upgrade Pack.
Right.
Yeah.
Ben had kind of mentioned.
That's right.
So, you want the Personnel Upgrade, You want the Personnel Upgrade to get the T-Series, but you also want the...
You also want the
Specialist Forces. Yeah.
If you've got the Battle Force... For clones, you might want to pick up Rex in case you're trying to run that. Or just in general, Rex is really fun.
Yeah, Rex is cool.
Rex is really good.
He's really fun as a non-200-point commander, you know? Right. Also the clone commander in the Personnel Upgrade Pack, similar to the T-Series. Be a great grab.
Yeah.
Very good grab. Very important grab.
very, very important.
Make sure to build your Echo and Fives. They're very important.
Yeah. I'm trying to think what else. Wookiees you can probably wait on until you want to go all three.
Yeah. So if you get the Clone Battle Force and the core set, you'll have one RT and one Bark. Whichever one you like better, you might want to pick up another one of it.
Sure.
Just to have some supports. And then whenever you want to get into big vehicles, pick up the heavy that you think is coolest. Lats can be fun for transporting Jedi. ISPs are fun fire support platforms, and Sabers are big, healthy tanks. You know, they all have a role. They're all fun.
Yeah, but I do think the best bang for your buck for the setup that you've got going is, I know it's another big investment and it's some very similar stuff, but getting that Clone Wars core box will be pretty instrumental.
I mean, it's
really rounding those armies out.
It's about the same price as buying two Phase 1s and two B1 boxes. And then you also get Obi-Wan Grievous and two supports and terrain.
And range rulers and barricades. And
yeah. And a bunch of upgrade cards.
That box will get you healthy way on both armies you're trying to build on. So
Yep.
Yeah.
The question, I guess the cores will give you a couple of Phase 1s. Mm-hmm. Just if you need bodies there. Do you recommend we go ahead and pick up the Shadow Collective? I know it's not part of the 501st, but all the winning lists with Republic seem to have a lot of pikes in them.
Yeah.
I don't think he needs to go into that yet.
I don't think you need to go another. We can't say, hey, go buy a, you know, $150 battle box and then another $100 core set and then another. How much is the Shadow Collective box?
It's $100
bucks?
Like 80, 85.
Yeah, something like that.
So I don't necessarily, for starting off, I think you'd have to go that way. I would suggest picking up, for your CIS at least, either Cad Bane, Darth Maul, or Bosk.
Oh, yes.
They can Maul's all actually, add a lot of – they're super cheap.
They're all
they'll
fun.
Help round out your army, and they'll give you some unique flair. And then Magnas are always amazing. I think you get one in the Battle Force box, but maybe getting a second set –
what haven't we listed for droids?
You're allowed to have Maul inside that particular invasion force.
That's so true. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's hard to find points for Maul and a tank and the rest of it, but it is there.
Well, and that's why I brought up the Republic heavies, is if you've got an AAT now with your battle force, it's like, oh, if you want to, if you're trying to have balance in both, a saber is fun.
But honestly, Legion's cool because you can go buy whatever you want. I would say whatever you want to build and paint.
Whatever catches your eye. You can make it work.
Some units are better, obviously better than others, but you play and practice enough with a particular thing and really get to understand it, you can make it work. So you're going to spend a lot of time building and painting. So go grab what you want to build, what excites you to build and paint.
In our local tournament for the CIS, I'm thinking about going for Invasion Force just so I can say that I've done it.
Right.
But I had a really good time with an AAT, some Stap Riders, and a bunch of B1s. I could have a good day.
I hate you. It's all things I hate. I don't know why I hate the CIS matchup. I really don't.
You hate it so much.
It fills you with rage.
I hate that matchup.
Cracks me up.
Okay. Now that we've been wholesome and helpful.
Yep.
Yes.
Let's get dirty. Let's get in the
mud. He would like to know why we are so hostile to ARCs and Fluttercrafts.
All right. Let me start with the ARCs first.
Yeah. Let's start with ARCs in a bubble.
Let's start with those guys.
At the very beginning, the ARCs touched us in our no-no places repeatedly often and at range.
Yes, they did.
They did.
So
standbys were shared, DCS, guns were fired.
They showed up and immediately yanked them by increasing the points so hard we never saw them again.
Well, it was not. It was not immediately. It was a year and a half later. they yanked them.
Well, and, 6 months later, they said no to the standbys.
Yeah.
Then a year after that, they still took the points down because they were still really good.
Well, it's because we're going to take away standby sharing and then give you Exemplar on our next three waves of releases.
Oh, that's true too.
Look,
that is also kind of true.
It's not my fault you can't kill Padme.
Because she's behind that wall and does nothing but grab.
She has to have line of sight to the friendlies. You can find her. But yes, the ARCs were very overpowered. Then they were nerfed.
Very overpowered.
Very, very much. Their sniper lost critical. They went up 6 points on the full team, and I think 6 points on the strikes as well.
Mm-hmm.
It was a spiked nerf bat.
It was great.
Yeah.
They deserved it. They did.
They deserved it.
But I think all of those added up is a bit much.
Yeah, no, I would agree. I would absolutely agree.
And so
right
now they feel quite inefficient when they're on the table.
Yes.
They have Impervious, but if you're not rolling the extra dice for that, they have the same save as any other clone trooper, mm-hmm. but you're paying mm-hmm. seven, like, you're paying quite a bit more of a premium per model, so each death feels yeah. a lot worse. Mm-hmm. They're still very good as a Bravery 2 trooper with tactical moving and shooting, but
yes,
that when you're paying 120 points for that,
yeah.
it feels bad when they start evaporating and now your move shoot is black, black, red.
If you could find a way to, like, consistently get two surge tokens on them, I think they would feel a lot better, but...
Echo can give you one, because he adds yeah. reliable. Then, if you're in 501st, you have to take a phase two. Yeah, I mean, you right. can build, or, like, aggressive tactics builds.
Do, like, yeah. an aggressive tactics build, yeah.
You can do stuff like that, but that's even but more points even into more trying points, to make yeah. an expensive unit okay.
Yep. No, I agree.
So... I love the arcs as far as thematics. I love what they do. Oh, and even when they were at their worst,
the models,
I appreciated them.
The models are fantastic. And the rules yeah. are very reflective of what I would want them to do. And I love yes. that they can have jetpacks. I love the whole kit,
yeah,
kit
and caboodle. They're probably one of the most flexible pieces on the table. That they can
oh, they're great. Sniper,
or they can shoot really good at range 2 or range 3.
I kind of wish they had another generic weapon option. Like, a you know, most of the other... Special Forces teams like this mm-hmm. have a saboteur. That would be cool, is what I'm saying.
That, no, that would be cool. I mean, honestly, that really surprised me. I thought for sure we were going to get an Ion.
Maybe a saboteur with jump is a little dumb. I don't know.
Probably.
I do not know.
Probably.
At this point, yeah. At the original price point,
we're
yes.
never going to get one.
No, but no, yeah, no.
It's anybody's guess.
But... They're still fun to use. Don't get us wrong. Like, move shoot with an aim and you're rolling, especially if it's range 2 and you can get red, black.
Yeah, if you can close.
4 black, 4 white. Maybe some surge tokens. Yeah, if you spool them up, they do really good work. But right now, they're just probably that points
yeah,
increase really hurts
them. 2 updates, they got hit probably about 3 or 4 different ways. And they probably needed to get hit one less way.
There's also yes. the issue of dice pool increases. I mean, you were seeing some fire yep. supports that had god-awful numbers of dice in them.
Yep, that you could essentially fix with all the token spam and shit.
Yeah, yeah. When you used to be able to spend an unlimited amount of aim tokens, you could take their die yeah. pool that doesn't surge and just say, I'm rolling this until it's all hits.
Yep.
You know, yeah. That and has also been limited, you know, so the non-surging die pool feels a little bad.
18 dice getting thrown at you, yeah.
Nowadays, I just have to do that with a support unit that has hit surge hit on its own, and then that works a lot better, and I kill all of
yeah.
those units.
I mean,
that
you
way.
Still got the merit of using them as a fire support platform, though, of a sharpshooter, which is nice.
Yeah, cool. But Wookiees.
But the points to get them there and get everyone lined
yeah,
up.
No,
and
sharpshooter Wookiees also surge.
100%.
Yeah.
there's a lot of yeah. better options in Republic right now. Hopefully that changes to where arcs become a more competitive choice, especially with 501st being. Very arc yeah. themed.
Yep, right. I agree.
But we'll see.
So for our event today, Will was created as we do our notes. And so we're using Longshanks as the moment for our board there. So you can track stats. I do actually like Longshanks. Will and I use it for Guild Ball. And so we went to go look at, you know, what the top factions were by number of plays in the 501st. Now, granted, it has a low data set. So it's not a ton of numbers for the 501st. But it's like was it 31% win rate?
36.
It was not great.
It's not great.
Yeah, and granted, that's just Longshanks, but I think if we were to go off to the fifth trooper and look at
and
their
that's
stuff,
events, it's if you have yeah. fun, play it. You know,
if you have fun, play it. Absolutely.
And hopefully, we'll get buffs for them in the future that make them better on curve with the rest of the Republic Special Forces.
Yeah, that'd be great.
That would be fantastic.
Speaking right. of things that should only be played if you're having fun. Flutter.
All right. Ben, I'll fight you.
Come up, Immersive.
I'm going to go make some popcorn. I'll be back. Guys.
Yeah.
I'll have fun.
Okay. I am not hostile to Fluttercrafts. First of all, it is the peanut gallery who has never seen or played a Fluttercraft that wishes to talk shit.
Hey, listen, I've seen plenty of Fluttercrafts because they're a bear to transport. Like,
you've
I've
seen them on a table that you
solutions.
Are playing Legion on?
Yes, I have actually. I saw them when I was judging tables. I actually
Hold
played
on. When
against
was the last
them
time you played a Fluttercraft, Will?
I played against them.
All right.
And got grenades dropped on my face, and I did not appreciate it.
Did not appreciate them at all.
But they I concede they're probably the third strongest support unit out of three.
Out of three? Yep.
Yep.
That is some faint praise we're damning them with.
But I do believe that if you're playing a niche, that if you're trying to create one at least, you would be more able to do so with flutters than with arcs. The investment is less of your list. They have more of a flexible approach where they have speed, they have flight, they have ability to move around the table with speeder and reposition. They can at least offer more flexibility as far as what they can do in a game than arcs do, is what I would say. That's if fair. We're comparing them. Now, just the unit itself, it's fun. It's not very tough, but it's fun. And I think in the right hands, with a lot of practice, you can get enough practice to know where they need to be, how you can hide, how you can move out of dangerous places, range control, play limb viz forever, stuff like that, to get them the right setup.
So I think that's my takeaway from Fluttercrafts. In the right hands, it is a high floor, high ceiling unit.
Yes.
You can do many things with it.
Your but first few games with it, it might just evaporate.
Yes, just pop.
And don't bring just one. That's one like the Wookiees we kind of mentioned. You got to kind of buy in and go all out with them.
Yeah,
you need multiples.
I think you can do two or three, but probably not just one.
Just one is kind of a weird side thing happening.
Yeah.
And again, thematically, the model is absolutely beautiful.
It's awesome.
It does exactly what you think it's supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
It does. The stats just make it doesn't hold up well flying directly at a thing.
Sure, and part of me is, as a Rebel player, would love to be able to add Fluttercraft to my arsenal.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I just don't think it... I think it's a fine unit. I just do not think it meshes with the rest of the Republic army at all.
Not really.
When you're building this clone gun line with, you know, Obi-Wan or Anakin kind of spooling it up and standing in place... And then you've got these three screaming banshees as the only thing running at your opponent. They're the only thing to shoot at. And so, of course, they're going to die. When I can shoot the thing coming at me in the sky that's got six wounds on a white save, or I can go after, you know, a six wound phase one with a red save behind heavy cover at range. Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to go after the thing that's about to run me over.
So they actually have... a lot of ways to mitigate the like problem of speeders YOLOing too fast.
Yes.
With reposition, they can actually do a very effective like non-move hover turn where you...
That's true. Yeah.
Move it at a hard right turn, reposition right, hard right turn back to where you started.
And there it's also to note that it doesn't make a difference on every table, but when it matters, it really matters. The fact that it's speeder two and not one.
Oh, yes. And
can make a world of difference.
And when you're not playing against Rebel Heroes, cover two will come in handy.
It will.
Always having heavy cover.
Sure.
It's your only protective measure. I think they have a comm slot, so you could put emergency transponders on them now.
Yeah, transponders is probably going to be a little bit of new lifeblood for them.
Yeah.
You know, for my T-47s, it's made a world of difference.
Yeah. I'm on Team Bowcaster with the Flutters. I think that's a sleeper pick.
Going to ask that question.
I think that you can do the move in place, two moves to get back to where you were. You keep the rear arc on them.
Yeah. Impact Pierce is a hell of a keyword combo. Yeah.
And it plays off your fire supporting clone troopers because now they're shooting into something with surges and Pierce and Impact.
Yep.
You know, if you've got an RPS rocket, now it's Impact 3, Pierce 1. That's pretty cool. So there are definitely options with that. I think what you said about it being a more isolated piece that doesn't fit in applies a lot more to the bombardier rushing forward and getting shot at, like you're saying.
What if you gave the gunner arsenal, just so you could use the back gun and the front gun at the same time?
I think the pilot's guy doesn't have an arc.
Yeah, he's not arc restricted.
It doesn't.
So then you'd always have an extra black die on your bowcaster shot.
Yeah, extra black white, yeah.
Yeah, if it's range two.
Yeah. Six dice out the back
side. It wouldn't hurt. It would not hurt.
Points, I mean.
79 with a transponder to have a dodge for that time you're exposed. Or an aim if you really want to do it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a It's a thing. It's got the, you know, the immune blast melee range one weapons. You're not going to catch any Jedi with it.
It's got the T-70 keywords, so it's not able to be just yoinked. Right.
I will say, like the T-47, it can actually hide behind high enough terrain.
Yeah. Yep.
Just because of the nature of its model. Yeah. The Fluttercraft has a little bit harder time for that.
It's bigger than a bigger, yeah, it's got a lot more spindly bits.
Yeah.
And to with catch vehicles, you just got to see any part of the plastic and and you can go after it. So
Yeah.
But I don't think that's the aspect that's breaking.
No.
I'm just saying
unit. You got to really think outside the box with them.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it just comes down to faction cohesion. And I think, like Will's saying, you can fit the gunner in probably more places. I think if you're going to go full Wookiee skew, the Bombardier is the way to go, as you tie everybody up in melee.
Oh,
with
your
Wookiees and then drop bombs on them. But there's a couple different ways to play it. But like much like arcs are not dead in the water. You just really have to have a plan with how to use both of these units. They're not plug and play, easy to execute like some of the others. And the criticism with arcs is for really the Civil War, because BXs have kind of fallen off because of better options. The commando strike teams are just so, whether they're scout troopers or rebels, are just so plug and play. Like that, they don't take a lot of, you know, inventory in your thought space, where you can just kind of set them and they aim and shoot.
They're sub 50 point, models.
Yeah,
the arc strike is 70 something.
Yep,
or 68.
I just can't see a place where you take a naked one, a naked Fluttercraft.
No.
Oh,
for 55 points, it's just not enough impact to do anything.
No, you take a naked
pain in the behind.
Take a naked Bark instead.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you get speed 3 and a red save.
Yep.
But I think the reason
naked RT for 60. I mean,
Barks all the way. I think the reason Fluttercraft have more popularity is just that if you're going to do a Fluttercraft skew thing, it's only 100. It's only like 200 something points rather than. You know, that's two units of arcs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Yeah.
So that it's easier to list build around the Fluttercraft idea and also have like a Wookiee chieftain and Wookiee units and stuff like that happening rather than trying to play the 501st with, or just a normal list with
full arc teams. If you're going to take, if we're going to take Flutters, you almost have to kind of run a pseudo Wookiee battle force in a way of thinking.
Essentially.
So. You say that, and every time we talk about this, like, well, we keep talking about like they're a faction, a sub-force, you know, a battle faction. Mm-hmm. And I really felt like
you
used
so many combinations of words there, and none of them were correct.
Sub-force battle collection.
I mean, but like the Wookiees felt like they were going to be the first battle faction that we had, right? I mean, they really, and this somehow didn't become that.
They were not the first war menagerie.
They're a pseudo battle sub-faction.
Yeah, I mean they've got special forces. They have unique command cards. So what if we just
a Republic there? Only? Yes.
I mean, they don't have a core. Like that's the problem. They don't have a core. Right. There's no Wookiee core here.
No.
So does it break the game if we say that the Wookiees can only use Wookiee onlys, which includes basically just the Fluttercraft?
Well, you can also just say you have no core requirement.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We just say you have to have Wookiee commanders. Ooh. Five, you give them five special forces. Five special forces.
That is so many wounds of Wookiees. That's
it's
terrifying.
Eight, nine activations. I think, because I actually been playing with Tabletop Simulator.
You spam with Fluttercrafts.
you get five Wookiee warriors with bowcasters, a Wookiee chieftain, five Fluttercrafts.
Five sources of Pierce Impact, I guess three Fluttercraft is eight. That sounds terrible.
Nine with a chieftain.
You get nine activations. You get some. You get hard for points at some point. Like you're in difficulty with that five. I mean,
I think the only
it'd be eight, nine activations.
I think the issue with that is there's not enough Wookiee options. So where you have what is it? Five units. You have the two Wookiee flavors: Chieftain, Chewie, and Flutters.
I mean, you. I think you do have the options if we're like going to weird wild Westland where you can take just Wookiee warriors as your options. Because we really, for Republic, have five Wookiee options. You've got shooty and melee Wookiees that can take, I think, are reasonable with both weapons.
Yes.
And then I don't think you ever take a shooty Wookiee with a battle shield, but
you could. It's an option.
It's an option you were legally allowed to do, and then I'll scratch my head and look at you.
Indeed.
but you really do, like, each, whenever you put a different configuration of Wookiee with a different heavy weapon, it feels like a very different unit.
Yes, but, I mean, there's just, it would be very samey, other than those different weapons. Like, it's...
Well, I think you need, yeah, I think you need the cheaper activations of, like, the core requirement is kind of a blessing, because you need cheap activations just to round out your act count.
I mean, you could do something like the Blizzard Force Stormtroopers unit, where it's like a, you bring a unit that's only, it's only three Wookiees that are, you know, three wounds apiece, and they don't have a special weapon option or a personnel upgrade. They're just three Wookiees with their pistols and swords.
Yeah.
And that's your core unit Wookiees, and then your special ones are have weapons, so they're special forces, air quotes. There are options.
Right.
Take the Kashyyyk defenders and then just strip them of keywords?
Well, and Kashyyyk, if you're doing a Republic Kashyyyk-themed force, there are clones on Kashyyyk. We just don't have those clones in the game, other than Phase 2s, technically,
and ATRTs. I mean, they were Phase 2s, it's just different helmets.
And... No, there's... Well, there are bespoke Phase 2 clones, and then there are also Phase 2 scout clones that we don't have in the game and we'll probably get at some point. I think as our third core option... We'll see. Give me Scout 1 core units, please.
No way.
So, all right, so let's say we Ryan just took it down cry. To... if you took Noble Fighters, gave them two bodies, that's still 6 health as a core, basically, to just drop their point cost down.
Yeah.
I mean...
Or you do something like...
Basically, 23 points apiece is what they actually cost per model.
Yeah.
It's 23 points per.
I don't know. Yeah, it's just there's not enough units to call it its own battle force, I would say.
Yeah, and my guess, we're not testers by any stretch. My guess is this was at one point a battle force early in development, and then they're probably just...
You could throw Yoda in, I guess. It was
not different enough to really merit the rules document that they knew that they were going to need to make it a battle force, and so they just kind of included it, which is the only reason I can see... they had to tack on all the command cards to specify that they're Republic Wookiees.
Yeah.
Or Republic only. When they decided not to make an exclusive battle force.
Even if the Wookiee command cards weren't Republic only, they all say when you're issued by a Wookiee trooper commander and you don't have
any. Which Rebels so do not have as of yet.
You would have had to get a Wookiee chieftain of your own or something.
We might get a Wookiee commander sometime soon.
Listen,
we'll see if ATST Chewbacca's grandfather. We may get ATST Chewbacca as a field commander.
I think
probably not.
I think the fact that Wookiees are not
Tim would cry.
I think the fact that Wookiees are not a battle force is what gives them a lot more of the flexibility, though.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I think it's probably a good thing for them.
I don't know. We all know that there are people out there who want this to be a battle force. Like,
there's the dude, I cannot remember his name. I met at LVO who he's like converted his entire army.
He converted everything into Wookiees.
Like, how many Wookiee expansion packs? Because it wasn't all just 3D printed. He bought so many Wookiees and then like
taped, reposed, you know, and like, green stuff,
Rebels E6s and all the weapons on him. Like, he was an entire army of Wookiees. It was amazing.
Leaving money on the table, AMG. Money on the table.
I think if they wanted, they could make it the second Battle Force with a new box that has other Wookiee options in it, like the giant pontoon boat heavy flying unit.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
On the
one that I thought we were getting instead of the Fluttercraft? Yes.
Yeah.
We got the Fluttercraft instead.
We'll talk about spindly flying bits. Will, that'll be even worse.
We do appreciate you. Like I said,
we appreciate it.
We do want Arcs
glad you're getting into the game.
Be more seen. Yeah, glad you're getting the game. We want them to be in the game. We just recognize that there are reasons why they're not right now. So
yeah,
yes, but
maybe someday.
Have fun
and
with
if
the
you go back and listen to old Stabcast. We weren't just hostile to Fluttercraft and Arcs. We were hostile towards the entire Republic faction for a year and a half.
I had my Throne of Salt. Yes,
and it was you lived on that throne for a long time.
Bro. I did
you
really years,
for quite some time.
And now it's dismantled and dissolved.
I took it briefly for a period of about 3 weeks when I was king of the castle with my Magnus and my spiders.
I took it back for about a month with Shadow Collective, and now it's Empire is who has
now the throne. Now it's all the speeder bikes.
All the speeder bikes, which can't sit on it because they have to use speeder.
The throne is actually carried between four speeder bikes. It's like... mm-hmm.
All right, so we got another letter that I think we're all going to have some pretty spicy takes on, and I'm excited for.
I'm still feisty. Fuck you.
Hey, guys, love the show. If Force Push was bumped up to 15, would you still take it? What if it was 20? At what cost do you think it's no longer an auto-include? Said another way, do you think the card needs a cost increase to see it? If it's more of a decision to include it or not. Thanks, Tusken Raider.
Force Push will always be the most game state changing card in Legion.
No other upgrade in the game.
No other upgrade. Change no.
Objective scores. You can push people out of intercept transmissions, off of key positions, away from boxes, off of evaporators, until we get another card that allows you to move your opponent's models off of objectives and change the actual outcome of games, it will always be taken.
The only thing, even
regardless of its point cost,
the only thing even close to it is Vader's Might, which is a one-time command card that lets you place enemy models and throw them.
It all of these options require at least 150 point investment.
Yes,
because you have to have a Jedi at a minimum. Yes.
I think does CIS have a way to, or not CIS, Republic have a way to move? Dooku's got a card that can move people. Luke's got a card in Serve Your Master that can move enemy units. Vader's got Vader's Might.
I do not have a card that can make enemies move like that, no.
Okay, so it's just Republic. Rip.
And Shadow Collective, technically, does not have an option. I care.
Shadow Collective.
Buff Shadow Collective. No.
I don't think it's a... So the original question, though, I don't think it's a point cost thing.
It's a design philosophy thing.
And the reason I say that is, like, look at Commander Luke. I think if Force Push goes up to where it's too expensive, not only does it go away, all of the Force users go away. All of the reason to take a Force users go away. Because I think a lot of the cost of Force Push is baked into how expensive Force Push platforms are.
Are you really about to argue that Force Push is okay because the tax is built in other places?
Yeah, I am. That's why we don't see Commander Luke, because Commander Luke is, you know, my cheapest access to Force Push, but he's so bad he doesn't get it. He doesn't have refresh. So you think you would take Jedi if they bumped up Force Push to a point cost where you wouldn't take it, where you fill those slots with other places, you would still play Jedi.
Republic also has two very different Jedi to your Luke comparison.
Yeah.
Mine are very supportive.
So, Maul doesn't have a Master of the Force piece, but he does have the ability to refresh himself.
Yeah.
And a card and the extra ability.
Like, yeah, an extra third action. Yeah.
Right.
Obi-Wan and Anakin can happily sit back and buff their army for a long time and then have a short spat of a duel. They don't live entirely in the dive, Force Push, last first, move out. Kind of thing. They can happily because of Force Push, but
because of Force Push.
I mean, I think the issue is separating
when you use it. Go ahead.
I think the issue is separating Force Push from the playstyle of Jedi because they're so intertwined.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So that's what I see. That's why you're coming from that angle. But if you try to separate it, it's like 10 points on the surface looks very cheap to have that much of an effect on the game board. But like you're saying, it's part of a bigger cost. I don't know. This is a hard one.
We got cheaper Jedi, like, you know, if we ever get the generic,
if Grogu had Jedi a Force commander upgrade
for Republic, that's like a 100 point Jedi unit. I think at that point it's okay to jack the cost of Force Push because it would kind of have to be expensive to go on such a cheap platform. But I don't think we'll ever see something, at least as it stands now, a Force user with a Force upgrade slot with under 140, 130 points.
I would hope not.
Commander Luke, I think we all agree, needs to come down, but he won't because of Force Push and because he has access to six command cards.
I would put him down to like 160 now?
He's whatever Maul is.
160. I'd put him at 145 or something. I mean, Anakin's 155 now, I think. Or is he one? I don't know. Anyway, Jedi are creeping down, but it's still... I get why you're saying we shouldn't have cheap access to it, and don't. but it's still such a powerful thing. I don't know.
It is. So that being said, if we can't fix it through point costing, what if we fix it by making it expendable? You get it once, but you only get it once.
It goes to 5 points, maybe? Or 10?
Yeah, whatever the point cost, it still makes it a thing. Because part of the issue with it is that you can refresh it.
With Master of the Force, it's such a... If you don't have an answer for it, it's such a bad feels like... I move your unit here, I charge them, kill most of them, push them away the next turn, charge a different unit, kill most of them. Like, it's the Jedi pinball. It's just your whole unit is dying and you can't respond.
Force push, I think, is one of those upgrades. I think we could probably all clearly remember the first game we played with someone who really understood how to play.
Oh yeah.
Force push Jedi pinball.
I'm still sore.
Just mopped the floor with us. It is the 10-point upgrade that I think separates good players from great players. And like Will said, if you don't have an answer for it, like, I don't think every list obviously needs force push, but you have to have a plan for it.
Yes. Which can just be, this is happening.
Like, yeah,
yeah. Know. Which is what I do a lot with my B1s. Yeah. Like, what's the thing that's happened here?
Oh, wow. How brave of you to accept the death of B1s.
Exactly.
I know I'm going to have to waste some time withdrawing out of the bubble wraps.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For those of us who have to spend points on core, it feels a lot worse.
I spent my 38 points solidly, sir.
38, God. Sometimes 50 with a weapon. Wow.
Yes, exactly. Sometimes...
Don't forget, he gets two extra wounds more than the rest of us.
Uh huh. Two extra bodies that you have to roll hits for, regardless.
Yep.
Yes. 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 Regardless of my blank defense dice, you do actually have to roll the hits first.
It's just, yes.
Anyways.
I mean, so we talk about this. I don't play a lot of Jedis in my CIS.
Yeah.
And I should probably, my Dooku, I mean, when I've done it, Maul Dooku is so gross because you're force pushing everybody everywhere to do all the stuff. Will has done some nasty things to me with Anakin Obi-Wan. I was like, ha-ha, and it's just ugliness. I mean,
I had
a great game last year in Austin or in Dallas where it was, you know, Anakin Obi-Wan against me and my Maul. And I think we were like, well, he's going to move him here. But then on the next activation, he's going to move him back over here. And now we're back in contact. And now Obi's going to go, so he's going to push somebody else out. I mean,
and I think it was just if craziness. You make force push and expend... I think that happens just even more where it just turns into force push chicken. Because whoever force pushes last gets the better end of the bargain.
Yes.
Yeah, but that means it either isn't getting played or it has to be used at a place where strategically it works. Which may be I push your guy out so I can shoot them. Or I push your guy out this one last, you hold it to the very end kind of thing.
I don't know that expend is the right answer. And I don't think that, it's tough, it's tough.
Part of me.
That's a good question. Thank you, Tusken Raider.
Thank you.
It is an interesting question.
Part of me doesn't like that the Force upgrade slot feels like it's resolved into there are three cards you choose, and then
there are some just bad Force upgrades.
Yes, 100%. There are, and there are some that are so niche that it's like, well, you could battle med, I guess. Like, there's different tiers of it, but it's just like reflexes, saber throw, Force push.
Like, I don't even know that I would put. Like, reflexes has gone a bit away because more and more command cards are giving ways to give those dodge tokens. I think you got to put barrier in that conversation.
Yeah.
I would especially put, Mr. Republic Obi-Wan Kenobi.
I would put barrier in, like, B tier with mind trick. Like, those are still useful, but have to be on a unit that has a plan for it.
Well, yes. I think Op Luke is probably the only one who ever considers Mind Trick just for serve. I don't know that anybody else ever takes it.
It's, yeah, that's what I'm saying. It has a very, barrier's probably a little less specialized than that. That's true.
Battle med's
gotten more Jedi with the ability to do a ranged attack. Saber throw has come away, but it's still.
There's a few units where you need it.
It gets like on Maul, who can make it four reds, it's amazing.
Or on Anakin, who needs to attack with Relentless, or Vader with Relentless. Right. Stuff like that.
It's like when Battle Meditation shows up and no one's expecting it because we haven't seen it in a while because it's not one of those things usually stapled in. Like,
they have that weird plan to do the order of the one thing that needs it, and you're like, oh, God.
But the cool thing about Battle Med is actually seen, in my mind, a bit of a resurgence, not because of anything about the card, but because we've gotten other things that do wonky things to get more orders out. So it's been indirectly buffed. Right. Which is really clever.
But that's where you're giving them credit. I don't know that that was an intended side effect.
I don't know that it was an intended side effect either.
Then there's guidance, fear.
Hope, and fear are so bad.
So bad. Now that there's a command slot upgrade for Inspire 2.
Yeah.
You can make force guidance free. I don't think people would take it.
And then lift.
I could see guidance being cool if it was not tappable.
Yeah.
I love what they tried to do with Force Lift. I love
it. No.
But also, I get...
Don't talk about the way they broke Lift. We don't need to bring that up. Force Lift,
it needs to not be in the game.
Well, yeah.
100%
it's not so dumb. It's such a dumb idea.
Because you can just win so many feels bad games with it.
Don't even talk about the thing, Ryan. We don't need to tell
Should
people...
Should I not...
No. Don't give someone the idea.
And I'm going to say,
I'm going to edit you out.
This to an opponent, you should feel bad and you're a bad person.
See, this is where I'm a nice guy and never even thought about actually blockading off a piece
if
of
you
this is where I'm going to bleep out the recipe to thermite that we're effectively publishing. Go ahead then.
No, our Turner Diary. This is known. People know this.
Your people know this.
Yes, the evil.
To where you.
Yes.
Well, they can alleviate that through the margin of error rules to make sure that doesn't happen. But rules as written, you can do that, and it's awful. Outside of that, though, Force Lift is a trash card.
Yes. And that's what's so terrible is that the only valid play is one of the worst things you can do to a person.
The negative force pushing them off a table. NPE.
Yeah.
So here's why I went with Expend, because I think we saw a great increase in burst of speed.
We have
a one-time effect that is a really cool thing the one time you need it.
I should have mentioned burst on that top four.
Burst is amazing.
Burst probably took Reflex's spot on the top three there.
Yeah, it kind of did. But burst for me is, unlike force push, it's something you only need once.
Would you do it more than once if you could?
It doesn't work. Because if you master of the force it back, and you've got immobilized tokens and burst of speed, then you're not really slowed down anymore.
So you only do it on three rounds out of the six,
which seems a little bonkers. We don't want Op Luke or Commander Vader or Palpatine moving speed three for half of the game.
But yes. But aren't we also saying that force pushing people six rounds out of a game seems bad because of how game changing it can be?
Yeah.
But force push. I would be.
It's speed one.
How many games
bad.
Are you force pushing six times? Because
at least
the thing with burst of speed is it's around you, and it doesn't matter where your opponent is. Force push at least has a range requirement. What I think they need to do rather than points, and I hate it, force push should probably have a line of sight requirement.
It doesn't.
It does not. No.
What the?
No. No, that's the thing. You could always be like, "Are you on the other side of this wall? I feel you.
I
come walk over here."
I never even thought about that.
If we want to, if the point of this conversation is to like make force push more of a question about whether I take it or not, and to add more counterplay around it, I think adding a line of sight requirement is the way to do it rather than points.
But here's the thing: I think 90% of your cases you don't worry about line of sight because you're looking at them; they're right next to you, or you're in combat with.
Yeah,
them.
It's never come up where I've not had line of sight.
I would disagree with that. I've used it all the time to pull people
out
from behind cover to be able to shoot them with the rest of my squads, not just the bubble wrap.
We've already talked about how you're a bad person. So
yeah.
You're right.
I'm kidding.
No, we're not.
Yeah. This is why. So force push, because we talk about this, because I play Grievous. He's a Jedi, but not a Jedi, because I don't get access to it.
I get
lightsabers. I get the scale. I get a lot of things that are Jedi-like. I don't get that piece of it. And so it makes a difference. And that's one of the reasons I think his cost came down. While Grievous' cost is now much cheaper there. But I think force push, when you can use it three or four times in a game, I do think that's probably at a place that's not great for gameplay because it so dramatically affects so many of the actual objective play.
All right. Thought. What if we add a similar restriction to Mind Trick where it doesn't affect other Jedi commanders, etc.? Because in the mirror of force push, it sucks. It is such a weird wibbly wobbly. I push
She's
you
a
charge here.
Non-
yeah, it has to be a yeah.
Ooh, I like that plan.
You can still pinball. Engagements, I don't know. Engagements get so weird in when it's Jedi with push.
From a thematic standpoint, I can't get behind that. For gameplay, maybe. But just the fact that, like, I can't push this Din Djarin just because he's got a little rank icon next to him, when I should be able to throw him against the wall to get away from him.
Okay,
but if it's just wizards throwing each other against the wall, we might as well be playing Lord of the Rings, because that's all it turns out to be. It's like, I'm now engaged with you, then I push you away so my guys can shoot you. Well, then I engage with you, then I push you away so my guys can shoot you. It just becomes a wizard fight.
Yeah,
so
let me
ask this question. Because I'm not making this argument, but it sounds like maybe Ben is, and I don't know if Will is or not. Are you suggesting that, like, force push is unbalanced? Like, it is. It needs addressing?
I kind of am. Now that we've kind of dug into it, now that I've really exposed my thoughts on this, I am because, don't get me wrong, you're paying the 150-point tax to get there. But those Jedis also have a ton of other things they do in addition to this this 10-point change the objective scores ability.
Because, once again, I played just Rebels. At that point, if Force Push gets too unbearable, Luke is then just a big melee stick. Why am I not taking literally two sets of Wookiees in his place? Because they will do far more melee damage than Luke's lightsaber will for this, like, point for point.
Because you can still play Serve Your Master and his command cards and his three.
Exactly. Like, his command cards make all the difference there.
I just take 12 wounds of Wookiees or 24 wounds of Wookiees instead of 7 wounds of Luke. Command cards be damned.
Your Luke also has disengage.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, he's also.
yeah, it's okay. Like, your Luke actually has ability to get out of there.
If I can go back to
he's also 200 points.
If I can go back to the unbalanced question.
Yeah. Sure, yeah.
I think inherently it is an unbalanced mechanic in that it is so one-sided that it's just, hey, I'm going to move your models here for a minute. Like, that is an unbalanced concept.
Yes.
I think that it is mitigated by what Ryan says with the availability tax and the kinds of units that can use it, that sort of thing. I don't know if that's enough. As someone who played Double Force Push, it's real dumb.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've done it a couple times, and it's real dumb, but it works well. I mean,
like, I was taking standbys, pushing their unit just to not move them. Obi-Wan would murder them, then Anakin would stand by, Obi-Wan would force push someone, Anakin would murder them, then Obi-Wan would get two more actions. Like, there's so many, like, plays and things you can do off of it, and your opponent has zero ability to say no. Like, if there was some way for a Jedi to also cancel a force push, that could be interesting.
You tap your force push to cancel a force push?
Yeah, some way to defend against it.
That would be interesting.
A counter.
So, with that said, if we look at SoCal,
yeah,
which I just pulled up the numbers for that, out of the top 8, how many force pushes do you think there were?
Maybe one.
There were two.
Okay.
There was one Anakin and one Luke. So I don't think it's obviously at that point not so broken that nobody can overcome it.
I'm saying unbalanced in the measure of not so much like overpowered. It's unbalanced in there's no countering it other than knowing about it and playing to not have it affect you, which is such a
there's no way for a thoughtful opponent to be able to counterplay, which is an argument that you, Ryan, have made quite often in this.
You can backstop it with height.
I think you can counterplay.
I stay at range 3 and shoot you in the face.
You have to zone around and create these no man lands that the force, because like so, making the
so you
the
concede
the
objectives
the force user,
great.
For until you can deal with the force push weapon, yeah. I mean,
so you're telling me that all of these guys who have two force slots are not going to put burst of speed in the other one to clear that zone?
I mean, they probably are. That's what I'm saying.
That's absolutely what they're doing. So now I've just spent 8 points to do it. I guess 13 if I really wanted to do it. I mean,
but once again, it's on a super expensive platform.
Yes,
who has 3 command cards or more and abilities in it itself.
I'm not saying that I want the like. I think that Jedi are an important counter to gun lines once they get into them. They can also be weak to gun lines if it's played wrong or if it just goes poorly and you get shot to death, that kind of thing.
Yeah, rough deployment or a rough table.
And
I
don't want Napoleonic B1 lines firing back and forth like Ben does.
Listen, Just because you lost that game by 20
I was about to say, Ben did start this discussion with, for having a vehement stance of no force, force push is broken. It's like, I don't play a lot of Jedi, but...
I think it's important to have an ability like this. I just don't know if it's... It just feels bad. And I don't know how to fix that with, while maintaining a way to have this much interactability with the board. Because I think that is... It's good to have in the game. I just don't know if it needs to be tweaked to be a little less much. Like, I don't know. I'm treading a weird line here that I like it.
Yeah,
and hate
I think it.
It,
I think it's fine to Tusken Raider's original question though, to make it more of a choice of your force power loadout. I don't think that'll ever be in question. I think just the nature of, like we talked about, a force push being able to determine games. I don't take Jedi because I want to play a cool Jedi character and a melee SKU. When I play a Jedi, like it means I want to play Force Push in a list, so therefore I have to take a Jedi.
Okay.
So the cart comes before the horse, if that makes sense. And I think if you separate those two ideas out from each other, I don't know that I ever play Jedi.
What if all Jedi go down 5 and Force Push is 15?
Well, that's just a stalemate. We're already there. I mean,
but then if you don't play Force Push, your Jedi is more value.
Ooh, I mean,
I still play Force Push because, like I said, I am playing a Jedi because I want access to Force Push.
I think part of the reason you don't take Jedi without Force Push is because part of the 160, 170 is Force Push.
Sure.
So if you can somehow separate that. Yeah. Maybe you can find a new...
Might be an interesting idea to kind of fiddle with.
Didn't they bring almost all those Force users down 5 points so they could have... Was it command upgrade? What was the... There's a 5-point...
They brought them all down 5-ish points, yeah. They just did it.
Yeah, just because there was a long stretch where people weren't playing Jedi because they were just too expensive.
It was Rex Stars and...
Yeah, it was Rex Star that pushed them out because they couldn't close that gap.
Well, yeah, and the mortar
Rex Star, it was great. You could just never get there with more than one health left.
Rex Stars and Empire mortars and things like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody just got like 5 points off, even Palpatine and Op Luke.
Oh, I thought that was an aggressive tactics fix.
No, I don't think so. But I think if there's some...
I mean, it's a great question, and that's one of the things. Yeah, I'm not saying it's overpowered.
And also,
I'm not saying it's destroying the game, but
I would love to see other more interesting, more active force powers.
Yes,
because I think that the force powers that we poo-poo, hope, fear, guidance, they are all very passive. They don't really they generate tokens or remove a token. They don't really change the way the Jedi works. And the force powers that we have seen really take resurgent, barriers, push, burst of speed, they have big effects on and change the nature of the game. And I think in first Star Wars, when our most iconic heroes on every faction are our Jedi, and the lightsaber is the most iconic thing in Star Wars, you should, whenever you take an action with a Jedi, fundamentally change the game state instead of here's two surge tokens. I would love to see them maybe instead of addressing force push, make the newer force powers that come out more dramatic and more game altering to where I'm paying for this big platform. And so what crazy flavor of Kool-Aid do I want my Jedi to have?
I mean, I think guidance, if you make it any other token, is pretty kind of interesting, at least. Like if it's two dodges at range two, including themselves for a tap.
Well, sure.
Like, but you have a mini
reflexes. You have reflexes a mini, never sees the light of day.
No, but that's why it would be cheaper. Like you probably pay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
There is a force power we have not talked about today, gentlemen. We haven't talked about anger.
I mentioned
anger and that it's trash. I guess I didn't even mention anger. We mentioned fear.
Anger is on Palpatine, and that's it.
Yeah, I was about to say anger has a place, and it's Emperor Palpatine, and that's it.
On his one pip turn.
Yep.
Yeah, because you're using other things on Darth Vader operative, because he only has two slots.
Yeah.
Yeah, and well, and anytime.
Oh, and it's the way you can guarantee the interaction on your own turn.
Yeah, you can get exactly. You can guarantee you
because otherwise
anger
it's,
only triggers when your opponent lets you.
Yeah.
Right. Of course, if you're not shooting them and letting them come in and do bad things.
Yeah,
that's kind of bad.
I'm I'm not going to not shoot them because they have anger, but if I'm shooting them at range three, like, what is anger going to do for them?
Yeah.
Unless they're Anakin and have Exemplar, which is like the only other time it's even useful, but still not, because Anakin has two slots and they don't need to be anger.
And a six wound Anakin that you're paying close to 175, 180 points for is not worth six aim tokens.
Correct.
As a battery as he gets shot at.
The thing that Padme does in three rounds with quick thinking aim.
Maybe it was with like whenever you defend, gain an aim token. That would be a little bit different.
That would be really spooky. But, at least considerable.
Taking wounds? No.
Yeah, but that's when you become basically Yoda. I mean,
is fear the bottom of the force upgrades?
Demoralize one.
I think hope is slightly worse. Jedi tend to dive away from their army. And like you're trying to inspire the thing you're running away from. Well anger at least.
Not if you're Obi-Wan.
Not if you're Obi-Wan
or Anakin.
But Obi-Wan has a command slot that could be.
And also Republic doesn't care about courage.
Phase ones do. They'd like both actions, please.
They like both actions. The rest of the army doesn't care.
Put hope and the new command upgrade on Obi-Wan for Inspire 3.
You could.
I mean, that's a thing you
it's
could
bad,
do.
But you could do it. Look, everyone, I'm like Leia or something. No,
she's still just two.
She have a command slot? You could have four.
You could have four. To be vigilant.
She has two command slots.
That's true.
The other is esteemed.
I don't think we're going to come to an agreement on this. I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing, but I understand where Tusken's going with this. There is a place where it is an auto-include. If you're bringing a Jedi, you're bringing this.
Absolutely it is. Yep.
Yeah.
And it's whether you think auto-includes are a negative thing for a game or not.
Yeah, that's true. We didn't even talk about that. We just talked about how impactful the ability is.
Does something that exists as an auto-include...
In my mind, force push should be like deflect or jump and just be printed on the card. In my opinion, the only reason it's not is because it's tappable, so you have to have a game component you can rotate.
Yeah
I can see that.
And it takes up one of your force slots.
Yeah, but I'm saying they've given every Jedi an extra force slot just so force push can go in there.
Yes.
Because I don't think we have a single one force slot force user yet.
Not yet.
Even Commander Lucas too. So it might as well be, in my opinion, it should be printed on the card. It's just not because you need something to rotate instead of like a force push marker that you put token that you put next to the mini that you flip over when they use the ability.
Listen, acrylic makers, Ryan is giving you ideas right now.
Ryan is team. It's required. I'm team. Yep. I understand why you hate it, but I also think we need to have something like it. Like, I understand both perspectives because I've played both. And Ben is, I don't like it because I've had it do bad things to me so much.
No, I wouldn't go that far. I'm fine with keeping the game. I think you make it expend. You get it once per game. I think that takes care of a lot of those pieces of you get to use it. It's insightful. You can use it at the very end if you want to. But I think it reduces a little bit of that pinball.
Crashing down in cost to be played.
Maybe twice a game?
I still think you're wrong about that. I still think you're wrong about coming down crashing cost. They do so many other things, Ryan. It's not like that's the only thing they do is force push. Yoda almost never has to use force push because he's never in combat.
That's
because he does
true.
All the other things. I mean,
sorry, it's he plays burst of speed and force pushes a bunch of crap. It happens. No,
that's true. Yeah, he can. But there's also gameplay where you're like, he's just going to sit back here, guidance everyone to move all the boxes so far away. You never see him again.
Yoda can do something that nobody else can do though, and give four units over the course of a game relentless for a turn.
Yes. Because he can play the card twice.
One, I don't think any other Jedi has that level of utility.
Republic Jedi are all a little off.
Yeah.
They have a little extra special something.
They get a little spicy.
Luke is primarily a blender, but he does have some utility command cards.
I don't hate it. I've used it. I've had it used against me. I don't hate it. I do see it. But I also see that there's a place where it is an auto-include, and I do think it has a lot more impact on the game. Because we've talked this many times. Do you have a response to Jedi? That's become a number one thing here.
If you don't have that, you don't have to have a Jedi yourself. But if you don't have a plan with how to deal with one, you need to rethink your list.
You at least need to know what you're going to do when one is on the table.
One shows up.
Yeah,
right.
Because they're going to be out there pushing things around.
Which is why often my response is, can I find enough bodies to go jump on one so you can push one away but not the other?
Uh-huh. Yep, 100%. And I also think we're going to...
That's why I bring two.
We've got some units that force push in a way is going to be kind of dampened. I think Din is going to do a great job. Anytime you can throw a red save, not that you necessarily want to, but with jump, you can make sure he... For me, if I don't have force push, my game plan is I'm going to determine where you have to spend yours. I'm going to give you a problem that force push has to solve, so you can't use it where you want to use it. You're going to use it where I make you use it.
So I think my one final thing.
Sure. Yeah, we'll move on.
Crossing over from another game set, Marvel Crisis Protocol.
No.
Briefly. Several characters have abilities that use mind powers, whatever you want to call it, to move other characters. Then there are certain characters that have, they cannot be moved by mind influencing abilities that move characters. Would it, going back to what I said about it applying to certain units, would it be better to have a like strong willed or something that says you are not able to be pushed? Something like that. I don't know. It's a huge part of the game right now, but it could be a neat design space to say like, no, you cannot push.
Could be. I still like your idea of me being able to use my force push to cancel your force push.
Yeah, that could be it.
Because then that means I don't have it on my turn because I don't get to master the force until the end of the turn.
Right. That could be interesting. Then, but you still have to be within range one of the unit being pushed, perhaps.
Yeah.
Force squish as you both try to push them and then they just get, they pop.
Force your head.
Force push is fine. But I think the way we get more variety, though, is the more I think about it, the more this is where I would love to see the game go, is just see more interesting force upgrades come out.
I can hear the absent fourth member of our podcast screaming about how force push is not fine.
Yeah, I really can. And I can, but you know what? In Tim's defense, our top list that we keep talking about, three speeder bikes, three barks, three speeder bikes. Like there's a ton of things that aren't getting force pushed.
Yeah, you can't push vehicles. That's that's your counterpoint. Push a vehicle. And that I heard that brought up. That's why bikes have become more popular than dewbacks, is that you can't control them. Like dewbacks can be pushed and engagements. That's true. So there's definitely
and the one way you can control them. They don't really care about like speeders because they get that free move are less worried about ion. Than other vehicles.
Well, and they're even less concerned now with where they are on the table too, because of the change to compulsory. And now you can like pivot first and do that kind of thing. I'm glad we have something like force push, but I also understand when that first time it happens to you and you just get pinballed, and if you feel like, how do I escape this? There's no way out. This card is broken. I understand that viewpoint.
And I also, like, reading Tuscan's letter, I don't get that that's where he's coming from. I just think he wants to see more variety of Jedi on the table, and I just don't think we will. Because for me, that's like asking how expensive does deflect have to be or jump one have to be for Jedi.
And that's why I can at least envision a Jedi without force push.
Weird Republic player.
Yeah, because I can guardian all my core or provide them all tokens and do all kinds of crazy crap with mine. I understand why your viewpoint is, no, I need as much game affecting utility as I have with murder and push and deflecting and jumping around and doing all the things Luke does. I understand why you don't have much else to envision, because you don't have much else. Like if you try to do
Luke's got nothing else.
Yeah. If you try to play Luke like an Obi-Wan, it won't go well. So maybe other Jedi will open that up for Rebels.
Operative Luke. It was a tap dancing. Like I want to do this thing. Then I'm going to slap that guy. Then I'm going to walk over here.
And guess what? I have disengage. Whee.
Yeah. I push away your one dude. Now there's only one other unit attached to me, and I still disengage from it. Ta-da!
Ben, you know what? They can't force push.
This is partly that the Rebels don't have another Jedi.
Nope, I mean, we don't.
Not yet.
Y'all
Ahsoka
could
is coming. I
mean, yeah.
Yes.
Next
year, Adepticon,
she's
maybe.
She's not ungodly expensive, and you know, Luke, double force push for Rebels is going to be real interesting if it ever becomes a viable thing, if it's not so ungodly expensive.
I'm going to start playing the Obi-Wan Anakin again just for the fun of it.
Yeah.
It's a good time for me.
But at that point, I would have three options for a Jedi. Will already has three options for a Jedi. You would only have two. I guess the Empire still only has two.
Technically.
But surely two of them are the same character at some point.
Yeah, that'll be interesting.
Yeah.
Inquisitors.
Yeah, we'll get Inquisitors.
It'll be like a Maul kind of cost.
Yeah.
I don't know if we'll get generic Inquisitors. That might be.
I think we might, and they won't have a force slot. They'll have some very Inquisitor-like abilities.
Okay.
Or we'll just get named them. We'll give them force push. Fifth brother and seventh sister or...
Yeah, I think they'll get access.
I could see the thing Ryan says as well, where they're just kind of like lightsaber wielding bullies.
Yeah.
Yeah, but welcome to Grievous. I mean,
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they'll have a little bit of that vibe to them.
Look at Jedi Hunters. A little surge on crit.
I mean, maybe it's a unit of two models that has like three wounds apiece or something.
Yeah. In helicopter mode.
All right, last thing I'll throw out to maybe make Will sad and maybe placate Ben a little bit.
Uh-huh.
What if Force Push becomes unique?
Okay, that's probably fair.
It doesn't affect Rebels at all because you only have one.
Right, like we talked about right now. But
two of them is a lot worse. Can confirm.
Two of them is a lot worse.
It is a compound problem.
Because then then you pull one in for a bubble wrap and then you pull them again with the other Jedi out of the bubble wrap into a new bubble wrap.
Yes.
Don't play hostage against me with two Jedi.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, right now, your faction is the one who makes people scared about that piece the most.
But... I did it three times.
Jeez. So
I moved Anakin up. Exactly. He force pushed on turn two, he force pushed the hostage squad. Then Obi-Wan did the same thing, and they were back past the center line on turn two. It was great.
And you're wondering why Bobby had to have a 20-point bid to make that thing work.
Yeah, that's why I'm cutting mine to 24.
I have a 100-point bid.
I'm going to play Bombing Run or Hostage. Which would you prefer?
Hopefully both of them fall the first two columns.
Somehow, I don't know how, but we made it to the 90-minute mark.
We can talk for hours.
We really can.
This is nature of us.
Yell about Force Push.
We had our...
I've given y'all like three options to close this episode out like already.
You have.
I tried to do one.
So with Ben saying that, he will force push us to the end of the episode. So thanks for hanging out with us, everybody.
Ooh. Right off the edge.
Spending your drive time, your paint time as we get pushed into this objective marker, or probably away from it.
Probably.
As a barrier is erected around us, smoothly ending the episode.
It's true. I'm Ryan Slawski, reminding you that, I don't know what I'm reminding you, force push is the best. Yeah, go force push.
Wow, what a strong conclusion you've come to.
It's true, yeah. No. Absolutely.
Wow, that's a really hot take, Ryan. Force push good? Wow.
Force push good. We'll put that on our new fanny packs.
On the inside lining. Yep. Well, I'm Will Heim, reminding you to come play our event on November 19th if you're in the area.
Yeah, we'd love to have you.
They'll be Grogu's.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you, the only force push that's a bad force push is the one that puts you next to the Dianoga.
Or the one that pushes you off the board.
Or the one that... Oh...
I can't believe we made that whole segment.
I brought it up. I said the only thing worse than building barriers around an objective was pushing someone off the table edge. And you just...
No, I didn't hear that. I should have taken that bait.
Yeah.
Good times. Good times.
Bad times. Brett still has scars on his mind.
He does. If we hadn't spent 20 minutes on force push, I was going to talk about the Wookiee People's Front of Kashyyyk, which is much better than
the only thing you can't force push are your... The only thing you can't force push is your Ewok AT-ST.
Yet.
You know, I've never seen anyone force push a Wookiee. What if they were immune?
They are heavy. You have to have a lot of push.
In the film. Like in the films.
You have a lot of push and power.
This goes back to our Logan. He's hard to push.
No more MCP. We're signing off. Good night, everyone.
Yes, let that be the closing music. Hey, well, speaking of cinematic moments and the sisters, the way friendship grows on camera and film.
Yep.
Photos be sure to check out our Instagram,
that game, by the way.
At SW. What?
It's true.
You broke in there like four times, buddy. Like, yeah. I'm trying to do a thing. What the hell are you talking about?
I'm trying to transition you. I was like, I did get photos of this game.
Well, then add that after he's done.
You're probably right. I will probably forget to post them on Wednesday, but I'm going to try.
You could just post them now. It'd be perfectly fine.
I'll probably do that.
I posted some photos during our chat right here.
Thanks for the paper, everyone. Good work.